found out.
Third time? Fourth time?
Fourth episode of Hashtag Ask Physioware in Live. We're nowhere exciting this week, just chilling at home on a Sunday evening.
Yep. Right, let's kick it off. Let's get straight into it. We have 20 minutes. Come on, go.
Okay, should we say something about Barna, do you think, first of all?
You can, yeah. What do you want to say about Barna?
I guess we want to tell people. So, tomorrow week, so 8 days from now, we're going to be opening Physioware in Barna, which is very exciting.
4th of September.
4th of September.
In case anyone's watching on tomorrow.
Yeah, 4th of September, Monday the 4th. So, I guess we just want to sort of reassure everybody in Donegal that we're not going anywhere, that we're expanding and definitely not moving. So it's going to be a busy time getting up and running, but fingers crossed it all goes well. If the people of Barna are half as supportive as the people of Donegal, I think we'll be fine. And we have a great team in place as well, which I think is going to make a big difference. So we're looking forward to it. Barna's beautiful. It's a lovely little village in the west of Galway, real community feel. So we're really excited to be a part of it. So watch this space. We'll have more stuff coming from Barna in the next few weeks when we get the doors open, if everything goes all right. So just back to our Ask Physioware in Live. We've only had one question in so far, so if you're listening and you have a question for us, please send us a private message because we're very likely to get to it tonight. So you can comment below if you have anything straightforward, if something more complicated, or if you want to remain anonymous, send us a private message on our Facebook page. We have it up here and we'll do our best to answer it.
Good. Right, so we'll kick it off with the first question. So the first question is a nice broad topic. Someone asked during the week and they said they suffer from frequent back pain on and off throughout the year.
So the question was, what exercises can we do for back pain? Will I go?
Yeah, you go. You take it off.
Back pain is a huge topic, and we really like this question because exercises for back pain is exactly what we should be talking about when it comes to back pain. For argument's sake here, we're going to pin this down a bit. We're going to assume that this is just your general back pain, so no sort of sciatica or neural involvement. Not that exercises are key for that as well, but just to guide people a little bit here. So most patients that present with back pain have got pain across the bottom of their back. It can be more to one side than the other. And a lot of these patients, it's first of all, it's very common, isn't it? Like,
what brings it on most commonly, would you say?
I think it depends on what age group, but it's usually after they've maybe done something that they haven't done for a while or lifted something a bit too heavy. Sometimes it can just come on gradually for no reason. Maybe
posture
they've been
related.
Yep, desk work related. They've done something at work. They've driven for too long in the car, a long journey. Something like that will trigger off the episode of back pain. Most people are definitely a bit apprehensive when they get back pain first because the pain can be so severe. But we know when it comes to backs, the pain doesn't always equal tissue damage. So that initial anxiety and fear of having sharp pain is really common. But back pain is very common. Literally, 85-90% of us will have an episode of back pain at some point in our lives. And in most cases, this calms down relatively quickly. For those that it doesn't, we now know that exercise is becoming a huge part of how we manage it. So this particular question is asking, what type of exercise can they do? Well, the good answer to that is that any type of exercise.
Yep.
That's the short answer. We don't, you know, people come in and think, oh, yeah, Pilates is good for back pain or
yoga
or walking. But we now know all of the national guidelines, the research on this says it doesn't matter what you do as long as you're doing something. So we'll work with our patients.
You say it doesn't matter. I mean, vigorous exercise is obviously going to flare up the back pain and make it worse. So obviously, it's in moderation. Same with all your back pain. Don't push into your pain with the exercise.
Absolutely. And like, if patients come into us in acute pain, then obviously we're going to guide them to what they can do. And for those patients, people that have acute flare-ups of their back pain, we'll be very restricted as to what they can do. But we'll find some movement or some exercise that's comfortable, and we'll run with that. And then as they recover, that's where it comes into finding what exercise you enjoy, because we know that if you continue to exercise long term, then you significantly reduce the risk of your back pain coming back.
Mm-hmm.
And that's where the motto of, you know, find something you enjoy and do it comes into it. So I know I was working with a lady recently and she was asking me about Pilates, but she had no interest in Pilates. She had no interest in coming into a class. Mm-hmm. And she was like, oh, you know, I heard it's good for my back. And I was like, in my own head, straight away, I was like, this woman is not coming into Pilates because I need her to find some activity that she enjoys in order to maintain her exercise long term. So we broke it down and we were like, well, what do you want to do? What would you enjoy doing? What's sustainable? What will work in your daily routine? And then it really doesn't matter if it's a walking program that we start, if it's a cycling program, if it's swimming, you know, if it's jiving, it doesn't matter as long as you're doing something. But what you said is right. Like, I would never just say to my patients, right, off you go on a 30-minute walk and that's your exercise for your back pain. You have to modify things at the start to what you can tolerate. Yeah?
Yeah, well, if someone comes in with back pain, you're not going to send them back out jiving straight away.
No.
You're going to build them up into doing a few simple stretches and exercises.
Absolutely.
And grade them up and get them back jiving, and then they want to stay jiving, and that's their way of managing their pain or managing their back going forward.
Yeah, and I guess then the next question often is how much, how often?
Mm-hmm.
And again, this probably dictates on what kind of, where they are in their journey. So somebody who comes in with a current episode of acute back pain where their pain is high, we'll probably have them doing a few exercises, little and often. And then once they're sort of recover from their back pain, then the guidelines really are at least 150 minutes a week. So, you know, 30 minutes of something most days of the week. And that's not only the guidance for back pain, that's the guidance in general. That's the minimum of what we should be doing. So we definitely try and get them to do something that they enjoy so that you can maintain that long term. I think the biggest thing with back pain when it presents first and exercise is that patients are really, they're afraid. Like, they come in and you can even see when they get off the chair how apprehensive they are about moving. And I think the biggest part of our job in those initial days is to really reassure and bring down that fear of exercise, fear of movement. Because the old thoughts were, you know, you rested for back pain.
Yeah, a few weeks in bed, lie down in bed and everything stiffens up, all the muscles start to weaken, and it actually makes it a lot harder to recover from your back pain.
Yeah.
But we would typically see people getting up and down out of chairs. I don't know if you can see me, but they're literally guarding their back, so they're really tensing all their back muscles, and then they're literally standing up like that to really guard it. But what you need to try and do is try and kind of breathe through it and try and bend and get everything moving to try and just get those muscles starting to free up and get them moving.
And like in that example, for that patient that's come in that amount of pain, we might start them with really simple leaning forward and back movements, sliding their leg up and down, getting them to think about reaching for their toes, really simple movements to begin with to get the back used to it, and to sort of expose the back to the movements that the patient has actually been avoiding. And with avoidance is spasm, you know, you're holding tension through yourself and that can actually make your symptoms worse. Yeah, that gives you pain. So I think we're trying to cover a lot with this answer, but in the early days of acute back pain, if you are noticing that you're avoiding movement, then please get to your healthcare professional for advice, because they'll be able to guide you on those initial exercises that may be pain-free and comfortable for you to do. If you're somebody out there who's had, you know, recurrent episodes of back pain over the years, you're feeling pretty good, then we would massively encourage you to go and find something you enjoy doing and do it for 30 minutes most days of the week. And that alone will significantly reduce your chances of back pain. I know, like, when we discharge our back pain patients, so say they've come to us, they've had their acute back pain, we've given them graded exercise, and then we've got them to the point of, you know, they're pain-free, they're back at work, they're doing what they want to do. And I always leave them, and my patients out there that are listening will know this, I leave them with their sort of forever exercises, and they say to me, I have to do this forever? And I'll say, yeah, you know, do this 30 minutes most days of the week and you won't be back into me. And it's amazing how little, once the pain is gone, they just drop the exercises. And then a year later, 2 years later, patients are coming back in saying, oh, it's back again. Oh, did you keep up your exercises? No. So if people can, and then the opposite to that, when patients maybe have really enjoyed the Pilates stuff we've given them and come into class, or they've gone off and joined the running club or done something, then we rarely see them again in clinic unless something sort of significant has happened. So I think in terms of what exercises are good for back pain, it's find something you enjoy doing and keep doing it.
Good.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think that settles that one. So we've got a few questions in already as well. So the first one is, what does your treatment for vertigo entail?
Okay.
Does it get good results if you add on to it?
I think with vertigo, we first have to find out what the cause of the vertigo is. And so there is certain types of vertigo that we will treat, and there are certain types that we can't have an impact on. So it really does need good diagnosis to what the symptoms are. If somebody is having the type of vertigo that we can treat, it's usually to do with problems going on with their inner ear without going into too much detail. For those patients, we have specific techniques. I know in clinic with us, it's Kath that deals with these patients. She's done her postgrad training in this stuff.
We might get her on actually.
Yeah, that's a good point. Yeah, and she can talk it through in detail. But
there's some maneuvers.
There is, yeah, they call it Epley maneuvers. So we do a thorough assessment of the patient to make sure that actually it's something that we can treat. Then you can do some tests to see if this Epley's maneuver might actually help your symptoms. And then we combine that with graded exposure to the aggravating movements. And it's a really tricky treatment, this, because often you can feel pretty horrible, and if you push it too far, it can be tricky. But if the vertigo is caused by inner ear problems, then Epley's maneuver with a graded exposure to the irritating positions and movements can see results. So I think for that question, it's probably best, first of all, to make sure you've been to your GP so that they have identified the cause of the vertigo. And then if it is to do with the inner ear and BPVV problems, then it is worth having a chat with us or getting in contact, and we can get Kat to give you a call back and discuss it further, because there is treatment options there.
Yep.
Good.
Perfect. And she's had it x-rayed and was told that it was ligament damage first, and to rest for a week. She rested it, went back, and was told it wasn't ligament damage, but it was actually wear and tear. But they couldn't be sure without a scan. So she's been referred for physio,
okay. But
wondering while she's waiting, what could she be doing in the meantime for her knee?
Okay, so just to kind of break this down a little bit, the main structures inside our knee are first and foremost the bones. There's two big bones that come together inside the knee.
How many?
There's two that matter. Well, three. Okay. I suppose your kneecap as well.
Yeah.
And your fibula is on the outside. So the two. Okay. Me that loves my anatomy. Typical. So your femur, which is your thigh bone, and your tibia, which is your shin bone, are the two big bones of the knee joint, and then your kneecap slides along it. The bones are covered in a smooth cartilage called hyaline cartilage, and then between them are these two chunks of meniscus, which I think we spoke about before in one other episode, which are much thicker chunks of cartilage. And then these bones are held together by four main ligaments, and ligaments are simply pieces of tissue that connect the two bones together. Now, depending on what age group we're in here, what we see is that if you have somebody who's, this is a bit of a generalization, but you're usually dealing with one of two things when it comes to knee changes if there hasn't been an acute trauma. So if the patient has damaged the ligaments, usually they'll come into clinic and tell us that they've had kind of a twisting injury, or they tweaked it when they were, you know, coming up a step or getting out of a car. There's usually some incident that would link back to them having twisted the knee to put pressure on the ligaments. So that's the key information we would look for when someone tells us that there's an injury problem. And then on assessment, we'd be able to identify if it was more ligament than going inside the joint. Wear and tear is like a pet hate of ours in terms of like a term that we use, because wear and tear is suggestive of something that's degenerative, that's going to get worse, that something is ripping inside there. But the reality is that wear and tear is just the normal changes that happen over the years within the knee. And they happen to all of us at some stage. Yes, some people are affected by it more than others. If you do have some cartilage change, and again, it's very common to have little tears in the chunks of cartilage as well.
More in the meniscus.
In the meniscus,
as opposed to
the smooth, soft surface. And again, lots of people have those changes. And we would find in clinic, yes, if you scan your knee, you'll see if there's changes in that cartilage. But as we say to our clients, a scan isn't everything. Like, it's still worth treating that knee conservatively. So absolutely, waiting for your physio appointment is important. And what we would do, if there is cartilage change within the knee, either the hyaline cartilage or the bigger chunks of cartilage, is really strength-based exercises, probably non-load-bearing to begin with.
Yeah. Yeah, pain-free exercise, basically.
Yeah.
So you're looking at things like a straight leg raise. You're looking at something like a bridge, as long as that doesn't catch. You might know from Pilates, or you can Google any of these exercises. Straight leg raise, bridge, even start to build up the outside of that hip as well. Doing things like the clam and things that really try and help offload that knee as well.
How many of those would you do?
I'd be looking for about 10 to 15 reps, and I'd be pushing for at least two sets. If you can do the three sets, all the better.
Mm-hmm.
For the raises, you just hold them for about 3 seconds initially, and then you can graduate it and build it up to 5 seconds if you're able.
And you want to identify in those exercises the difference between soreness in the muscles working and actually pain
soreness
within
the
knee.
Joint. Yeah. We don't want to push through pain.
Exactly. We find that you need to find the right exercises that you're not irritating that joint, irritating the cartilage, and then you'll start to strengthen the knee.
It can be quite effective.
Yeah, it absolutely can. You'll know within a month to 6 weeks of doing it, you'll know symptoms will have started to settle. The one thing we would say though is sometimes it can take a bit of playing around to know what exercises are the right ones. So give them a go, and then, you know, if it's irritating, it's stop and seek further advice. We have a golden rule here. If you're in any doubt, you need to get it checked out. But non-weight bearing strength work is definitely the first way that we would go with it. We've actually had another question linking into similar cartilage issues in the knee. It says, "Hi guys, the other half has torn his meniscus in the knee. He is due to have an arthroscopy and have the meniscus sewn back together. What is the usual recovery time for this? And should he be doing some exercising leading up to his operation next month?"
So, first of all, the meniscus, they do one of two things. They either shave it away, so if it's kind of on the outer side.
So they
either shave it away, which generally they get back a little bit quicker,
mm-hmm.
or sometimes if they sew it, it's going to be a little bit more delicate because they obviously want it to take and give it a chance to heal back. So you need to be just a little bit more careful in how you load in the initial stages after that operation. But in terms of your recovery time, like in terms of getting maybe back to work and pain-free walking and things like that, it does settle down quite quickly, so you're probably looking at 2 to 4 weeks. But if you're looking at getting back to sport and getting back to active running and things like that, you're probably looking for a little bit longer period to again give that a chance to heal and settle. So
also, you're going to be restricted here to what your surgeon allows,
mm-hmm.
because of them, as Ollie said, if it wasn't a sew in the meniscus situation, if it was just a shave it, then you'll be back walking in a few days and you'll be back running within 6 weeks. Within a few days it'll feel really comfortable and you'll be back running within the 6 week mark with good treatment. But when they suture the meniscus, the surgeons can put a restriction on weight bearing. So the
which is
because they want it to heal. So it's worth just dropping a call to that surgeon's secretary and asking what are the weight bearing restrictions after a meniscus is sutured, and that will give you a much better idea of what the restriction will be post-op. So some surgeons will give you like a 2 week, maybe even non-weight bearing, and then graded.
And sometimes they
like
to put
in
a brace as well to try and stop the rotation effect.
If they suture it, it's very different if they don't suture it. But either way, it's a straightforward surgery.
Yeah.
And once they lift whatever restrictions that they give us, you fly after it. Like, you get the knee bending, you get doing your strength work, and you really do recover. You know, within 2 to 3 months, it's behind you, and you're moving forward.
Easy. But again,
it's all about doing
your strength work and building the quads.
That was the second part of the question. Should he be doing some exercises leading up to the operation?
The stronger you get it before the operation, the quicker your rehab will be afterwards, because obviously the muscles aren't going to wither away overnight from the operation. So if you can set yourself up at a higher level before the operation, makes it much easier in your recovery. So doing the exercises, simple exercises, again, like we said, non-weight bearing exercises to begin with, and then you can gradually build it up. So you could be doing, again, the straight leg raises, the clams, the bridges, things like that.
And exactly like Ollie just said, it depends on how, because these meniscus tears sometimes post-op are not that irritable. It's only when you hop twist on it that it's sore. So definitely he should be doing strength work. If he's not and not too sure, then link in with a physio in your area and get them to do up a program, because you want to push the knee as much as you can without irritating it pre-op, because that really makes our job really easy post-op. So yes, go and get some rehab done in the next month and it'll be a lot easier afterwards. Good, those are good knee questions.
Perfect.
Hope that information is helpful. I got it. Flies. It's already 5:10.
It's what, 25 minutes gone already? Right, coffee's low. I think that's enough for tonight. Back and knees.
Back and knees, yeah. Covered. So hopefully you found the information helpful. Any other questions, please send us private messages and we'll be back again next week.
Yeah.
And we'll answer them to the best of our ability. So hopefully that was helpful.
Any idea what time next week? No?
I have no idea. Where are we next weekend? We're actually going down to Galway next weekend to help finish the clinic. So we'll probably be in Galway on Saturday night. I'd imagine it'll be next Saturday night.
Saturday.
Because then you're back up on Sunday.
Yeah.
So yeah, next Saturday night, live from Galway. Any questions, do let us know. Thank you everyone for watching. Have a good week.
Take care, guys.
Bye.